watch me.
Touch me. Tease me. Victimize me.
Grab me.
Grab me.
Stalk me.
Violate me. Sexual. Touch me.
Sexual harassment. No one asks for it. Visit noOneAsksForIt.com to pledge your support.
This is Edinburgh Student Radio Station. Fresh Air.
Fresh Air, tea in the park.
Hi, this is Sam
and Dan.
We're from Architects, and you're listening to freshair.org.uk.
Fresh Air at the world's biggest music festival.
We're here for freshair.org.uk at the Latitude Festival.
Fresh Air events. The biggest student club nights in Edinburgh. Brought to you by Fresh Air.
Pop and grind, the only 90s and noughties R&B club night. Western show, the only 50s and 60s club night in Edinburgh.
Who's bringing you news and discussion from across campus and the world on Edinburgh Student Radio Station.
And it's a good evening to the First Minister, Alex Salmond.
Vous écoutez Fresh Air.
Fresh Air! Fresher than ever. This is Edinburgh Student Radio Station. This is Fresh Air.
Hello, namaste, ni hao, hola, and welcome to Around the World with Sonal Katyal. That is me. It's 2 p.m. in the afternoon and you are listening to freshair.org.uk. This show is about us, the people from different parts of the world, living under one roof, the beautiful Edinburgh. Every week, we travel to a new country with our guest on this show. We learn about their culture, the traditions, history, food, and much more about their country. Also, we enjoy some cool music from their country. In short, I'm taking you all on a world tour. So, the country we are exploring today is a very interesting one. Famous for its flowers, picturesque canals, windmills, wooden shoes, Delft blue earthenware and cheese, this one has a lot to boast about its culture and history. Cycling is a way of life here and it is known to be the healthiest country in the world for its nutritious diet. This is the country where the Dutch live, the classic, timeless, artistic, vibrant Netherlands. And to tell us more about this country today, we have in our studio Mr. Emiel de Lange.
Hello, Sonal. Thanks for pronouncing my name very well.
Yeah. Thank you. So, Emiel, how has your day been so far?
Yeah, so far it's very cold today, but as I'm Dutch, I'm used to that. But it's okay. Okay. How are you?
I'm also doing good. It's cold, but I'm an Indian. It's not that good for me. So, do you study here at the uni?
Yeah, so I've just started a PhD here in Edinburgh.
Ooh, PhD. So we have a future doctor here.
Yeah, I suppose so, yeah.
Okay,
so not the medical kind,
not the medical doctor, but the doctor.
Yep.
So, how where do you live in Netherlands?
So we're from Amsterdam.
Okay.
Amsterdam East, to be exact. So the capital city. Yeah.
Okay. How would you describe Netherlands? That was my introduction, but according to you, how would you introduce Netherlands?
I think you touched on a lot of the things that we're known for. I think Holland. I say Holland, but technically the Netherlands is a small country, mm-hmm. but I think for the size, a country that has punched above its weight on the world, and I think we're quite a proud country. Mm-hmm. And yeah.
So, and how different is it from culturally or in weather or in landscapes from UK? What difference do you find?
So, I think we're broadly quite similar to the UK. We're very close, similar weathers, that kind of mm-hmm. thing, but having lived in both, I think there are definitely a lot of differences. I think Dutch people are a lot more sort of open about saying things, and they're not as reserved as the British, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, cycling. It's very different here. There's a lot more cars, mm-hmm. but, you know, it is a lot hillier, so I can see why. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of differences, actually.
Okay, and tell us about, like, the cycling, right?
Yeah.
Is it a very big part of your lifestyle there?
Yeah, so in Amsterdam and most of the Holland and most of the Netherlands, people cycle. It's like the main mode of transport. Mothers take their kids. We have specially designed like buckets that we put on the front of our bikes to hold children, seats that go on the front, on the back, carry our shopping. You know, we go to the airport and have our wheelie bags behind us in the bikes.
So, you go to the airports with your suitcases on bikes.
I've seen it happen, yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, so like airports, train stations, you'll see huge sort of parking lots of bikes. We even have underground ones with conveyor belts and everything. So it's a big part of everyday life there.
So if we want to imagine a street or say a road in Amsterdam, how would it look? More cars, less bikes, or too many bikes and just one, two cars, or no cars at all?
There might be a few cars parked, but there won't be as many driving around as here. In the center, you have tram lines in the middle of the streets as well. So the streets tend to be a bit broader. And there'll be very kind of separated bike lanes with a different kind of surface, different color. So it's very clear where the bikes are. Usually, even the bikes are sort of more on the pavement than on the road. So it's very safe, yeah.
Yeah, so you have a bike lane everywhere, like throughout the city?
Pretty much. And you can even go between cities on bike lanes. And
ooh, that's nice. And tell us about something about Amsterdam. Is it bigger than Edinburgh, or is Edinburgh bigger than Amsterdam?
It's bigger than Edinburgh. It's almost twice as big as Edinburgh, I think. But it still feels like Edinburgh, a bit like a little village where, you know, you often meet people and run into people that you know. But it's still the capital city, and it has, you know, a lot of culture, a lot of museums. So many tourists, just so many tourists, much more than in Edinburgh. So yeah, I think it has a lot to offer in that respect.
Okay, and what about the food there? We have heard that it's the world's ranking first in nutritious diet, healthy diet, plentiful diet.
Yeah, I was surprised when you told me that earlier. I don't, you know, Dutch people, we don't tend to like value our food that much. I think it's quite boring food, but I guess it seems that it is healthy. Yeah,
healthy food is usually boring.
That's true. So our staple foods are like just like mashed potatoes, sausages, cabbage, that kind of thing. Obviously, we eat pancakes, quite famous for that, and we fill them with things like bacon or cheese and fruit. But a lot of fish. Like historically, the country was a big fishing country, so there's still a lot of traditions about the first harvest from the sea, herring and eel. And we eat those raw, by the way. And I think the other thing is cheese. That's probably what we're most famous for, yeah.
And which is the most famous cheese?
So there's a few, but I think the most famous is, and I'll pronounce it correctly so you can all do so in the future, Gouda.
So it's not Gouda cheese.
It's not Gouda, it's Gouda.
Gouda. Gouda, right?
Gouda.
Gouda. It has that K sound.
Very guttural G, yeah. Gouda.
Gouda cheese, okay. So I think that now it's time to give our listeners a flavor of Dutch music. Emiel, would you like to tell us about the first piece that we played today?
Sure. So I tried to kind of make a chronological thing. So the first piece is from way back in the 16th century, the Dutch Golden Age. One of our most important composers, Sweelinck, and he worked in Amsterdam in one of the main churches and wrote music for the church there.
Okay, so what is the piece called?
Oh, I don't actually know. It's got a Latin name, and I don't know it off by heart.
Okay.
Maybe you can see it. Yeah.
Let's listen to this one. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, that was Puer Nobis Nascitur by Jan Peterson Sveilink. And the next piece I chose is a folk song. I don't think Dutch people know a lot about their folk music, but I had to find this one. So it's called Te Haarlem in den Houten.
Haarlem in den Houten, keert de molen naar om. Daar woont de meiske stoute, om en wederom. En keert de molen naar om. Dat hoort een der knapen, keert de molen naar om. Die wou bij het meiske slapen, om en wederom. En keert de molen naar om. Zij sloot mij in den kiste, om en wederom, en keert de molen naar om. Men zal uw moeder schenken bij, keert de molen naar om. Zij zal ze wel tevreden zijn, om en wederom, en keert de molen naar om.
Okay, so as far as I know, this song is about a creepy forest near Haarlem where some people were disappearing, and because there's some people living in the forest who would kidnap people. I think that's what the song is about.
Ooh, like the bandits.
Yeah, a group of bandits living in the forest.
Uh-huh. That's nice. So, Netherlands was reclaimed from the sea, right?
So parts of it were reclaimed from the sea.
How does that affect the landscape? Does it make it more fertile? And
yeah, so one thing that people notice when they come, I think, is that the landscape is completely flat, especially in Holland, like the part around Amsterdam where people mostly visit. It's completely flat.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have any hills for miles. And so, but I think this fact has had like a big influence on our culture, and it sort of defines the way our society works, because it was a hard work to kind of get rid of the water and actually have land to live on. So, you know, a lot of our institutions are built around water management.
Okay.
And we're famous for engineering.
Mm-hmm.
The windmills that you see everywhere,
mm-hmm.
their purpose is to pump water out from the land and pump it out over the dike back into the sea. And Amsterdam as a city as well is built on a kind of swamp. So all the houses are built on big, they're called piles of wood that kind of keep them stable. But my house here is about 10 meters below sea level.
Ooh, so like is all of the Amsterdam or like all of the Holland, like I was reading that most of it is like below sea level, just 1 meter.
Yeah, most of it's just a meter or two below sea level, but
mm-hmm.
the east part of Amsterdam where I live is East Amsterdam is a particularly deep part. Yeah.
That's interesting. And so that must be a very fertile land then, right?
Yeah, that's right. So we are lucky in that sense because it's so kind of full of nutrients left over from the ocean or whatever. We are the second biggest food exporter in the world, which is quite amazing for such a tiny country. The first is the US, which obviously is massive.
Any famous like crops because of this fertile lands that you export or...
Maybe not like uniquely Dutch, but next time you're in the supermarket, have a look, because I think a lot of your vegetables, tomatoes, the bacon that you eat is all coming from Holland.
Ooh, that's interesting. And also Netherlands has a very vast history, the Germans, the Spanish, the East India Company, so much to talk about. Would you like to tell us about the history?
Yeah, there is so much to talk about, and I'm quite interested in this topic, but I can give you a little bit of information. So I think...
Yeah, so from where did it start? Like the interesting part.
Yeah, so I think Netherlands as a country started around the 15th century when we basically rebelled against the Spanish, the Frankish Empire. And this was like the northern part of the Netherlands. So there is more to the Netherlands that is no longer part of the country. So in Belgium, for example, they still speak Dutch as well.
Okay.
But the difference is that in the north we were Protestant, so we couldn't tolerate Catholic Spanish rule. So we rebelled and formed a country, the 17 United Provinces. That's the kind of beginning of the Netherlands as a country under William of Orange. He was sort of the founder of our country. And then because of our sort of history of water and building ships and fishing, we quickly sort of had to start trading, and we became probably the biggest trading country in the world. So the Dutch East India Company, was and still is the biggest company to have ever existed, and basically amassed huge fortunes on which the city of Amsterdam is built, for example. So that was in the golden age of the 17th century. Went to Indonesia, went to the Caribbean, Brazil, India. We were the only country to trade with Japan. And mostly it was spices that we brought back. And also, this was kind of the beginning of the market system that we have now. So the first stock market was the Amsterdam Stock Market, and the East India Company was the first company to be traded on a stock market. And a lot of the financial instruments that we use now are kind of draw their origins from there. And then probably the dark time in our history was the Second World War. Obviously we're right next to Germany, but small country, couldn't put up much of a defense, and we're occupied for most of it. But we did put up a resistance while we were occupied, and as a result of that, the Germans actually cut off food supplies to Holland, and so there was a famine, and genetically actually you can still see effects of that famine in the Dutch people today. Might be why we're so tall now, as a kind of compensation, I don't know.
But tall is good, so you can be happy with that.
Unfortunately, I'm only average.
But you're quite tall enough for the people who can't see. Emiel is quite tall enough. And with whom do the powers lie? Do the powers lie with like the king or the businessmen? Because trading is such a big part.
Yeah. So I think because of our history of as trading, we're quite an open, tolerant society. We have a king still, but he's just ceremonial, really. He doesn't have any power. So we have a, just like in England, we have a parliament, two chambers and a government. Unlike England, though, we have proportional representation. Our governments are always coalition governments. And actually, I should mention in history, one thing that the British don't often remember is that in the 17th century, the Dutch invaded Britain. And William of Orange became king of the British. And that was called, is now remembered as the Glorious Revolution in Britain.
That's nice. So, but Netherlands is now a very democratic and a very tolerant country, right?
Yeah.
There are so many rules that exist that, you know, makes it very liberal and gives freedom to people there, right?
That's right. Yeah, I think we're famously tolerant and open. And that might not necessarily be because Dutch people themselves are very tolerant, but they're willing to tolerate other people doing things, you know. So Okay. You know, we're the first country to legalize gay marriage in the world.
Yeah.
Obviously, there's a lot of drugs that are legal there that you can't use here.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's good. So let's move on to the next songs we have on our list today. So which is the next song, Emmy?
So the next song is by Johnny Jordan. Jordan is a neighborhood in Amsterdam, a working class neighborhood. You should definitely visit if you're ever there. And it's famous for the musicians and singers that came from there. And so this song is a sort of anthem for Amsterdam as a city. And he's just basically saying how beautiful it is. More beautiful than Paris, he says.
Ooh, so it's like whenever you are like feel very patriotic and all, so you all sing this?
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, let's listen to your patriotic happy anthem.
Kopenhagen was een weekje in Parijs om de contributie te verdelen. Ome Piet de secretaris zet om maanden voor die tijd in zijn eentje Frans zitten leren. Maar toen niemand hem verstond, deed hij mal. Want hij zong op de Place Picot. Geef mij maar Amsterdam, dat is mooier dan Parijs. Geef mij maar Amsterdam. Mijn mogens parade, geef mij maar Amsterdam. Wits en Amstel en het ei, want in mogen ben ik rijk en gelukkig tegelijk. Geef mij maar Amsterdam.
Geef mij maar Amsterdam, dat is mooier dan Parijs. Geef mij maar Amsterdam.
Die ogen Eiffeltoren ging de bakker haast op zeep. Van de hoogte kreeg je te pakken. Als de slager niet toevallig net zo'n lange stalte greep, had die nood geen brood meer gebakken. Van de schrik gingen ze gauw naar beneden. En toen klonk op de Champs-Élysées: geef mij maar Amsterdam, dat is mooier dan Parijs. Geef mij maar Amsterdam, de mokums paradijs. Geef mij maar Amsterdam, met zijn Amstel en het ei. Want in moken ben ik rijk en gelukkig tegelijk. Geef mij maar Amsterdam. Zonder poeder in Parijs met een miljoen.
Geef mij maar Amsterdam.
Yeah, cool. And always fills me with pride that. And the next song is by André Hazes. And he's like a really famous, popular singer from the 60s, I believe. And the song Blut, Zweet en Tranen, which means blood, sweat and tears.
You're listening to freshair.org.uk.
Freshair.org.uk.
Edinburgh Student Radio Station.
Heb het goed gedaan, maar ook zo fout gedaan.
als ik terugkijk in de tijd. Een lach met tranen, zo voel ik mij vandaag. Geproefd van het leven, zoveel vrienden ongekend. Gekend, maar ook verdriet gekend. Hoe vaak stoot ik mijn kop, maar toch, ik ben tevreden met alles waar ik ben. Als je roem voorbij is, moet je kijken wie je nog kent. Wat echt gezien? Nee, ik heb geen trek. Ik blijf niet gek dat ik iemand straks nog mis. Ik blijf echt alleen, ja echt alleen. Geen gezeur meer aan mijn kop, ach rot nu maar op.
Around the world with Sonal Katyal, that is me. It's 2:30 in the afternoon, and today we are talking about Netherlands with our lovely guest, Mr. Emiel de Lange.
Hello, hello.
So, Emiel, healthy diet and cycling. People seem to be very fit there. I'm sure sports would be a great part of your culture too.
Yeah, there are definitely some very, very popular sports, and that last song you heard is actually an anthem for my local football club, Ajax Amsterdam. And football is something of a religion in Holland.
So is that the most famous sport there?
Yeah, football and then maybe skating and hockey, ice skating that is.
Oh, tell us something about the football culture there.
So if you ever watch football, you may have seen the Dutch team recently. I think we came third in the last World Cup and second the time before that. So.
Ooh.
We have a good track record for such a tiny country, I think. And people go crazy when the team does well. Mm. But also people support local teams, like really down to like the lowest amateur levels. It's a lot of support. And in Amsterdam, the team is Ajax. And that, you know, when Ajax plays a game, the center of the city is a war zone.
Okay, so you have like intercity matches as well.
Yeah, a lot of hooliganism as well. fights between different clubs. And well, that's less now, but in the past it was definitely a problem.
So do you play football?
I play sometimes, yeah. I'm not like a full-time footballer, but my brother plays a lot and used to play at clubs in Holland. Yeah.
Nice. And what about the ice skating?
Yeah, so ice skating is really historically like was a major pastime when the winters, all the lakes and water, obviously there's a lot of water, would freeze, and then people would just get on the skates and go out into the ice. If you go to a museum of Dutch art, you might see paintings from the 16th, 17th centuries of lots of people out on the ice. It was like something that they painted a lot because it was such a big like social event. These days, I don't know if it's climate change or something, but the ice doesn't freeze that often. So unfortunately, I've only had a few opportunities to do that myself. And there's a big race that happens when there is enough ice called the Elfstedentocht, which means the 11 cities tour. And it's basically like a grueling sort of tour past 11 cities, takes a few days with people on the skates, big national event, but it hasn't happened for quite a while. Yeah.
I've heard like around 15, it's happened like 15 times now, and like thousands of people are there on the frozen lakes that you have and skating through. It must be a very huge event.
Yeah, right? It's huge. Like people stop what they're doing, stop work, go to watch, go stand along the rivers and watch those skaters come by. Yeah, my dad said that if it happened, we wouldn't have to go to school. But unfortunately, it never happened while I was at school, so.
Okay, so 11 cities, how many days did you say it takes?
I don't know. I know it takes more than one day, so I think they're skating for a day or two or three. Yeah.
Oh, so are they like small cities and like shorter distance? Like, because 11 cities is too much.
Well, you know, city. What is a city? It can be quite a small town, I think, that counts as a city. And it all happens in one province as well, so it's not even across the whole country. Province, Friesland, yeah.
They're the Frisian cities?
Yeah, so in Friesland, the
Frisian people.
That's quite an interesting province. They have their own language, Fries, which is the language most closely related to English of all languages. And the black and white cows that are massive milk producers, they're from there, the Frisian cows. Yeah,
the one that's hanging out from the wall in Cowgate.
the same one in Cowgate.
Cowgate cow comes from Netherlands.
That's right.
Okay, and what all okay, so football, sports, and what all do people come together for, like some celebrations and festivals? You have native celebrations.
Yeah, we have a calendar. So, you know, historically, we're a Protestant Christian country, so a lot of it revolves around those sort of religious celebrations, even though I think now over half the country is declared as atheist. But we still celebrate something called Sinterklaas, which is like our sort of version of Christmas, St. Nicholas Festival on the 5th of December. And it's been quite controversial in the media lately because of his sort of helpers, which basically are in blackface, and now there's some debate about whether that's racist or not. But that's the tradition, at least. So he comes from Spain on a steamboat and on a horse, goes across the rooftops and gives kids presents. And we eat a lot of kind of food, especially at that time of year. Like we have sort of spiced biscuits, speculaas, and these kind of spiced hard nut things that he would basically throw at kids at school or whatever. And you scramble and get as many as you can and eat them. And also a New Year we eat these big deep-fried dough balls covered in sugar, and that's delicious too. Another celebration is the king or queen's birthday. At the moment we have a king, but in April it's like a sort of national day, and everybody wears orange, and there's street parties everywhere, and the canals are filled with boats playing music, and it's really cool. It's a really big thing, yeah.
So music, orange dresses, that seems so beautiful.
And the morning is nice too because it's a sort of open market. You can sell anything you like anywhere. So people, you know, the night before reserve spots on their streets where they can set up a little stall and sell all the junk and the stuff they don't want anymore.
So you don't book a spot, you just grab the opportunity.
Yeah, you grab it. You put tape down to make say, yeah, this is mine. Get a prime spot on the high street or something.
That's so nice. That's nice. So, which song do we have next? So, we have a song called Testaments by a Dutch songwriter called Boudewijn de Groot. Did I?
That was perfect. Boudewijn de Groot, yeah.
Yeah, and in this song he is speaking about his youth and how the mistakes he did, the fun he had. So I hope you all will enjoy this song.
Na 22 jaren in dit leven maak ik het testament van mijn jeugd. Niet dat ik geld of goed heb weg te geven, voor de slimme jongen heb ik nooit gedeugd. Maar ik heb nog wel wat mooie idealen, goed van snit hoewel ze uit de mode zijn. Wie ze hebben wil, die mag ze komen halen, vooral jonge mensen vinden ze nog fijn. Aan mijn broertje dat zo graag wil gaan studeren, laat ik met plezier het adres na van mijn kroeg, waar ik te veel dronk om een vrouw te imponeren en daarna de klappen kreeg waarom ik vroeg. En dan heb ik nog een stuk of wat vriendinnen die wel opgevoed en zeer verstandig zijn, en waarmee je dus geen donder kunt beginnen, maar misschien krijgt iemand anders ze wel klein. Voor mijn neefje zijn mijn onvervulde wensen wel wat kinderlijk, maar ach, ze zijn zo diep. Ik behoorde immer tot die groep van mensen voor wie het geluk nog altijd harder liep. Aan mijn vrienden laat ik gaarne het vermogen om verliefd te worden op een meisjeslach. Zelf ben ik helaas één keer te veel bedrogen, maar wie er eens proberen wil, die mag. Mijn vriendinnetje, ik laat jou alle nachten dat ik tranen om jou ontrouw heb gestort. Maar onthoud dit wel, ik zal geduldig wachten tot ik lach, omdat jij ook belazerd wordt. En de leraar die mij altijd placht te dreigen, jongen, jij komt nog op het verkeerde pad. Kan tevreden zijn en hoeft niets meer te krijgen, dat wil zeggen, hij heeft toch gelijk gehad. Voor mijn ouders is het album met de plaatjes die zo vals getuigen van een blijde jeugd. Maar ze tonen niet de zouteloze praatjes die een kind opvoeden in eer en deugd. En verder krijgen ze alle dwaze dingen terug die ze mij te veel geleerd hebben die tijd. Ze kunnen mij tenslotte ook niet dwingen groot te worden zonder diep rouw en spijt. En dan heb ik ook nog enkele goede vrienden, maar die hebben al genoeg van mij gehad. Dus ik gun ze nu het loon dat ze verdienden, alle drank die ze van mij hebben gejat. Verder niets, er zijn alleen nog een paar dingen die ik houd, omdat geen mens er iets aan heeft. Dat zijn mijn goede jeugdherinneringen, die neem je mee zolang je verder leeft.
Such a nice song. The next one is by Herman Brood, so it's more like rock and roll. It's the kind of music I think my dad grew up with. And just an interesting little fact, if you ever go to Amsterdam and see the Amsterdam Hilton Hotel, not only was that where John Lennon and Yoko Ono did their sort of sleep in for world peace, this singer Herman Brood also jumped off the roof and killed himself. So yeah, I hope you enjoy
to Fresh Air.
Specialist in alternative music on freshair.org.uk.
Fresh sounds chosen for you on Fresh Air.
Going down the line, head up high. wonder why it's so hard to feel fine. Got all I need, plastic tea, a bucket full of speed, and I'm cool in the heat. Could be little lady, since I'm wasting her time. Got a head and a bullet, I'm still back in crime. People say I used to do better. I guess I'm gonna have to get myself together. But I never be clever. Some say I'm suicidal with a sense of humor. Some say I'm faking it up, trying to start rumors. Some people say that I won't last long. Find myself a home, settle down, write a song. But I love to hang around in black people's places. Fascinating, staring in their faces. Holy mama, make me concentrate. Got to write a song and I got to create. But I'm never clever. You know that I never ever will. I'll never be clever, speed and I'm cold with the heat. The groovy little lady seems I'm wasting her time. I don't watch out, move back to crime. People say I used to do better, so I guess I'm gonna have to get myself together. But I'm never, you know that I never, I'll never be clever. I never ever, I'll never be clever.
So, Emil, have you made many friends here from different countries in the uni or the, wherever you live?
Yeah, in Edinburgh, there's so many people from so many places in the world. It's really cool.
Yeah, so what? If those friends come to visit you back in Amsterdam, where will you take them? Which places or tourist spots? Or
I can actually answer this from experience because I've taken quite a few friends back. I think the coolest thing about Amsterdam is just the sort of architecture. Walking around the center of the city is like a World Heritage Site. And just quite different to here. You've got the canals, lots of really grand old sort of golden age buildings that belong to merchants. Got a big city hall, which is really cool, and sometimes you can go inside and they've got really cool sort of global maps, some of the most accurate maps at the time, in the marble floor. But yeah, more generally I think people go to the Anne Frank Museum. I've never been there, I have to admit. There's lots of museums about all kinds of things, especially art. We have a lot of art in the Netherlands, so
The paintings are very famous from the Netherlands,
yeah,
right?
We have some very famous paintings and painters, mostly from the Golden Age, like Rembrandt and Vermeer, but also Van Gogh, from the 19th century. He has his own museum, and then there's a state museum for the Golden Age stuff. And there's also a museum of modern art, which is really cool. But yeah, I think
so mostly the museums are based on art and sculptures, right?
Yeah, but we have, with more than that, we have a film museum, which is a really cool building. And we have architecture museums. There's museums about the war. There's a museum about Amsterdam, the history of Amsterdam, which is really definitely worth a visit. I think people also should visit the markets. The markets are really cool places to kind of taste some authentic Dutch food, fish, the raw fish, and other kind of sweets and stuff. And yeah, markets are quite a thing here. Like, not in Amsterdam. I don't think they're such a big thing here anymore, but people do actually like go and buy their shopping and their food at markets mm-hmm. in Amsterdam. And there's lots of cool neighborhoods around the center as well that are more diverse, maybe. For example, where I live in East, I live along the River Amstel, mm-hmm. and we have some nice old buildings along the riverside, but then behind that is quite like a new regenerating area. There's lots of cool restaurants coming up. There were some great clubs, hotels, bars. There's a lot going on in Amsterdam. And I think you should stay as long as you can.
And any other cities that people can visit other than Amsterdam?
Yeah, there's obviously around Amsterdam, and there's some old big cities, and that area is called de Randstad. Everything's very close. You can go to The Hague or Rotterdam in less than an hour. Mm. Or Leiden is an old town. Delft is obviously famous for the Delftware.
Mm. The blue and white earthenware, right?
That's right, yeah. Rotterdam is, although there's a bit of a rivalry between Amsterdam and Rotterdam, and my dad won't like me saying this, but Rotterdam is cool because it was bombed during the war, so it's very new. A lot of modern architecture, big bridges and things like that. And it's obviously, I think it's the biggest port in the world, maybe. But then in the countryside, it's definitely worth seeing. If you've never seen that flat landscape mm-hmm. and how much water there is, that often surprises people. And there are some really cool sort of preserved old style towns where, you know, there's like floating houses and lots of old windmills still working. And
floating houses.
Yeah. Mm. Oh, actually, Amsterdam itself is full of houseboats as well.
So where are those houseboats? Like in the canals or?
Yeah, in the canals. So all the canal sides are kind of lined by them, which is a bit annoying actually because it reduces the view, but I'll let it be.
Okay, that's nice and interesting. Okay, so let's move on to our next song, which is?
Yeah, so this one is not the whole song. Just maybe listen to the first few minutes of this piece. It's Louis Andriessen, who is probably our most important composer at the moment. And mm-hmm. this is a piece of kind of mimicking an art style called De Stijl, which was, you may have heard of Mondrian, like those famous paintings with the squares and the blue and the red and the yellow.
So this person is quite like working in the present.
Yep, he's still alive and working now.
Okay.
And greatly respected.
Edinburgh Student Radio Station.
Thank you.
That was a very interesting piece of music. Next is a very modern one, like EDM, right, Emiel?
Yeah, that might have been a bit different to anything people listen to usually. I think the next thing, Holland is quite famous now for its electronic music, and it's really popular, it's quite mainstream. And for example, people may have heard of Armin van Buuren, Tiesto, really big DJs that are all from Holland. I'm not going to play something by them, but I've chosen something electronic that's quite cool, and he's quite a popular guy in Amsterdam at the moment, playing in the clubs and stuff. So this is a song by Tom Trago.
So now it's time to move your bodies.
That's right.
We'll be right back.
Okay, Neil, now we are at the last part of our show in which the guest teaches us some words from their native language. So which words do you have for us?
So I think the word I'd like to teach you first is the word gezellig, because it will be challenging, but also it's a very important word in Dutch language.
Gezellig.
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 Gezellig, right?
Sure, yeah.
What does that mean?
So it's actually a word that doesn't have a translation in English, but it kind of means a mixture of being cozy, feeling comfortable in a nice place, but being with good company. So it's something that is really important to Dutch people, and when we're in a nice social situation, that's the word we use to describe it. But I don't think there's an equivalent in British culture.
Ooh, so it's like winter night, fire, good food, good people around.
Exactly.
Blankets.
That's right.
Gezellig.
Gezellig, yeah.
And next word, maybe goodbye, because we have to wrap up.
Okay. Yeah, the way people say bye to each other casually is doei. We say doei.
Doei. Doei. So cute, doei.
Yeah.
Oh, and like see you later would be?
Well, depends. We can say it in many ways. We might say tot snel, which means see you soon.
Tot snel.
Tot snel.
Oh, it has my name in it. I like this one. Tot snel. Tot snel Dewey, right?
Dewey, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Emiel. It was really nice to have you on our show. I hope you had fun.
Yeah, I really enjoyed being here.
Yeah, and thank you to everyone who is listening to my show right now. I will see you again.